By the turn of the 20th century, Santa Barbara had experienced the industrial advances brought on by the railroad and, in 1902, the automobile. But a new invention was on the horizon that in Santa Barbara would spur innovations, create new businesses, and begin new industries that would impact the entire world. It was an invention that would provide critical assistance to the war efforts in World War II and provide essential equipment that helped put astronauts on the moon. That invention made its first appearance in Santa Barbara on New Year's Eve, 1910.
Well, Santa Barbara's first air exhibition was held out at Hope Ranch. And actually, it started off with a guy named Captain Ivy Baldwin, who was going to come out here and hold an amazing sky festival, as they called it. But then the sweet in the pot, a guy named Didier Masson, also agreed, a French aviator, he agreed to come out to Hope Ranch. So now it was an air exhibition and a duel between these two daring aviators. Though Didier Masson always gets the credit for having the first flight in Santa Barbara, actually, Captain Baldwin flew first. His plane got assembled. And he flew, I think, December 31st, putting his plane together, made a few flights, and nothing for the exhibition, just for testing. And so it was on Sunday, January 1st, and Didier Masson's plane went up and just thrilled the crowds out there. They charged $1 admission for adults, 25 cents for children. The train trip was 15 cents round trip, so everybody came out there. There was no end of Santa Barbarans who wanted the chance to go up in one of these machines. I mean, even though they're crashing and killing passengers and killing the pilots, the mayor was going to go up on Monday. A reporter for one of the newspapers, a female, offered to go up on the plane. And so, you know, everybody wanted to go with the dashing young Frenchman. On Monday, January 2nd, he took off from the Hope Ranch field for the second day of the exhibit. And this time he flew way high, did like 3,000 or more feet. And people are watching him, seeing go out of sight. Meanwhile, on the ground, every kid with a bicycle, every motorist is following this airplane. Where is he going? What is he doing? Well, he went down and buzzed the tower of the Potter Hotel, scared the bejesus out of the people that were up on the deck on top there, buzzes by the tower, banks out over Stearns Wharf, turns around and comes back, heads towards the Potter. Now, there's palm trees along Cabrillo Boulevard back then. So he just clips the palm trees and lands on the front lawn of the Potter Hotel. The people just go ballistic. They come streaming out of the hotel. They pull him out of the airplane. They're toasting him with champagne. I mean, he just got a rock star's welcome to the Potter Hotel. Looking at how much room he had to land on that front lawn, this guy was, you want to say nuts, brave? I'm not sure, but daredevil for sure to try and land that plane. And it is said that he was dragging his feet to help slow it down as he went across the front lawn.
The flight of Didier Masson stirred the imagination of many in Santa Barbara. Among those were two brothers poised to establish a legacy that continues on today.
Now, a lot of people have heard about the Loughheed Aircraft Company and the famous Loughheed Skunk Works that developed some of the top secret planes. Don't think too many people know that Loughheed had their start here in Santa Barbara.
They were raised here as young boys for quite a while, so they understood Santa Barbara. Their shop was in the William L. Russ Garage, which they rented part of at 101 State Street.
The start they had here in Santa Barbara actually goes back to 1891, when their mother, Flora Haynes Loughheed, came to Santa Barbara with her husband and lived up in Mission Canyon for a while. And the story is often told that the populace would say, look at those Loughheed kids, they're always down at the beach flying kites.
Their first airplane of anything was a homemade, what they called Model G seaplane. And their seaplane was different than most seaplanes. Most seaplanes that you think of today have a hull. They made essentially a big floating platform and mounted the plane on top of that. And that was the secret, because they could come up on a ramp with that kind, whereas most seaplanes have to come down in quiet water and then put on a dolly and pulled up.
Now, there's certain people wondering, why was it the Model G? And Loughheed later had said that it was because, well, if we said Model A, they would have thought it was our first one. So we wanted investors to think, we have been doing this for a while. So Model G, this is our seventh model.
When they built the airplanes, they had to get it to the beach. So they took the planes down State Street to Cabrillo, turned west. And in 1914, there was a huge storm in Santa Barbara, wiped out the old wooden bulkheads. The city built concrete wall, which is still existing down there, and it ended at Castile, because Castile was the way for people with horses to get onto the beach.
The Parks Commission said, well, you know, this ramp is going to make people on horseback have to do a 50-foot detour around the ramp. And I'm kind of thinking, you're on horseback. What is a 50-foot detour going to do to you? Well, the community, of course, was behind it, and various people raised money to help the Loughheeds put their ramp in. And the idea was that trying to drag this airplane across the sand was very hard. It took some 20 men to get a plane up there. But on the wooden ramp, one guy could do it. The Flying A was also here at that time. And there's a number of newsreels that were shot and stills that were shot of the Flying A actors and actresses going down, taking rides on the airplanes.
It was kind of a case of helping each other, because suddenly the Flying A studios had the ability to take airplane photos. And so it was a big deal, and it made money for the Loughheed people and got them the ability to make movies showing all kinds of shots from the air.
Their top star, Mary Miles Minter, christened the airplane when it was on its initial voyage down the ramp. She broke a bottle of spring water, which might be Santa Barbara's very own Veronica Springs mineral water that she broke over the fuselage. The plane took off, and it was a great success for the Loughheed brothers. The first passenger at the Loughheed seaplane down at the West Beach was a man named Peveril Meigs, and we recognize the Meigs because we have Meigs Road, which of course led to Mr. Meigs' farm. And so Mr. Meigs was the first passenger on the Loughheed plane, and the second passenger was his daughter, Leonora. One of the early employees for the Loughheed company was a man named John Northrop, and so John Northrop was a Santa Barbara High School grad of 1913. And as far as I know, he didn't have any training beyond that. Yet in 1916, he went to work for the Loughheed brothers, and he was their primary engineer. And he said the Loughheed brothers really didn't know anything about engineering, yet somehow he had a natural ability, I guess, to do this thing, because he designed certain wing factors and the shapes of the airplanes. And in fact, it could be said among the many Santa Barbara firsts is the first wind tunnel. And there's a story that Northrop had a large glass tube, and he would put various experimental parts in there, take a couple puffs off a cigar, and blow it into the tube to see how the air flowed over the wings.
Although Allen and Malcolm Loughheed seemed poised to help the United States war efforts in the First World War, fate would dictate a different path for the brothers. Eventually, the aftermath of World War I led to the demise of their Santa Barbara airplane manufacturing enterprise.
After World War I was over, the government released all kinds of Jennies for $300 each, brand new, with the engines and the crates, etc. And eventually the Loughees were just taken out of business because everybody was giving rides at much lower prices, and you didn't have to come to the harbor. You could go anywhere.
They eventually converted their seaplane to a land-based plane and tried to then grab everybody's attention by having a transcontinental flight, but it ended sadly in Arizona. There was a crash, so they trucked everything back to Santa Barbara, converted the plane back again to a sea-based plane.
And so they gambled the last of their money on a plane called the S-1, which was really a John Northrop aircraft that started to revolutionize how airplanes were made, because they used a molded wooden lamination to mold the body. They got around all the wires and cables that held everything together.
So Northrop's designs were very beneficial for the Loughheed brothers for the planes that they were building at the time. Eventually, they all parted ways. The Loughheed brothers folded their Santa Barbara operation. Their airplane was attached by a company called local company called Archer and Callis, and the plane was towed across the boulevard to a vacant lot, and it sat there for quite a while.
Yes, I do have the Loughheed propeller off the F-1 flying boat, and I got it from Hap Hazard, who was a very well colorful bicycle shop proprietor here in Santa Barbara when I was growing up. And it was given to me by Hap because he went out to the airport one day and was standing at the airport on the sidelines there on the flight line, and my dad was there with his staggering beach and saw Hap and said, hey, do you want an airplane ride? And so my father gave him an airplane ride in a staggering, and he never forgot that, and he thought my dad was such a great man for giving him this ride. So he wanted to do something nice for me, and he said, you know, would you like to have this propeller? I've been saving it all these years. It came off Loughheed seaplane.
And of all those early Lockheed airplanes, none of them exist, just the photographs. And we do know that their F-1 seaplane, the big twin-engine one, was eventually just burnt across the street from the launching ramp.
Right after World War I, a number of private fields were started, mostly on ranches and farms, all the way from carpentry up to the Goleta Valley.
Including the cow pasture in Hope Ranch, where Didier Masson began his historic flight, and the Lockheed's first airport in the sea, there were a total of 13 landing fields in the Santa Barbara, Carpinteria, and Goleta area. The Corona del Mar airfield that stretched from the end of Milpas Street to the Bird Refuge, the Rice Hunt Moore Field, where the Milpas Street exit off the 101 freeway is now, the Lowe Flying Field on the Mesa, the Chadbourne Dones Field, later the Carpinteria Airport, the Pomato Landing Field off Glen Annie Road in Goleta, and Parsons Field near Highway 150 were all active for many years. Some still remember those early fields.
Ballard, who had the airport at that time, he used to let me sit in the airplanes and play like I was flying, you know. And I haven't had occasion to meet Lindbergh, and I had occasion to meet Jack Holt and all these guys that flew, you know. I was kind of a regular customer.
One of Santa Barbara's early pioneers of flight was Earle Ovington. Ovington was one of the country's leading barnstormers in the 1920s. He had become nationally famous for being the first pilot to deliver airmail in the United States.
It was really a dangerous stunt to have this large sack of mail on his lap while he's trying to fly a plane. And he knew that he couldn't land the plane with this bag, so he made arrangements beforehand to let the field in Mineola know that he was going to just throw it overboard. So he flew over the Mineola field and threw the bag overboard and hit the ground, burst open, and all the letters went flying. And all the postal workers and kids and everything were running around picking up the mail. But a lot of them were stamped aerial dispatch from Mineola. It was a very special first time.
In the early 1930s, Ovington and his wife settled down in Santa Barbara.
Earle Ovington had property in the Samarkand area where the community golf course is, and so he had a private airfield there.
Well, he purchased 80 acres of land and developed 40 acres with the Casa Loma development. And I'm assuming he had in mind making use of the additional 40 acres for himself. And one of the first things he did after he built the subdivision was to clear a airfield space. I believe it was a 1,000-foot runway, but it was probably a dirt runway. And from my understanding, there were, you know, a number of incidents at the field, whether it was because of the runway conditions or, I'm not sure, I don't think it was paved when he initially created it. But it was good enough for him. And I think he always held out that if you were a good pilot and conscious of safety, you could land anywhere. And he certainly proved that. He did train a lot of local pilots in the area. He spent the time mentoring them and got them their licenses.
Looking at the Santa Barbara Municipal Golf Course today, it's possible to imagine the main runway of the Ovington Airfield, located on what is now the 11th fairway. The Ovington Airfield is also linked to another prominent figure in the history of aviation, George Hammond.
Earle Ovington actually wrote a letter of recommendation to the people that owned Ryan Aircraft, Claude Ryan, asking them to hire my father, who had just graduated from the University of Berkeley. So he worked alongside all of the men when they were building the Spirit of St. Louis and had a personal relationship with Charles Lindbergh. In fact, Lindbergh actually sent a postcard to my father saying he was coming to visit. I think it was in about 1938. My father had an airfield out on Hammond's Beach in Montecito, and it had about a 1,400-foot runway on it. My dad wanted a place to land his airplane, and his sisters wanted a place to practice polo. So there was a combination polo field and golf course and landing field, you know. and probably not one of them were perfect, but they were all, considering it was in somebody's backyard, worked out pretty well. He would fly to San Miguel Island to take the mail over to the Lester family, which had a ranching operation on San Miguel Island from the late 20s up until 1941 when the war started. Douglas Corrigan actually was a friend of my father's who became famous by having an airplane in New York trying to get a permit to fly to Ireland, and they wouldn't give him the permit, so he put fuel in it, told everybody he was going to California, and ended up going to Ireland and told everybody he went the wrong way, so we got the nickname Runway Corrigan. He actually took one of my father's airplanes from the field in Montecito and took it down to Carpinteria where they did some work on it, and then flew it back to Montecito and ground looped it on landing and crashed it. And my dad was always annoyed at Douglas Corrigan because he had to pay him to fix it after he wrecked the airplane. My dad lived at a very interesting time because he learned to fly in a Jenny, and his last airplane was a twin engine jet. So it was a pretty interesting time in aviation. We certainly aren't going to see that again.
As aviation started getting bigger and better, of course, the call was for Santa Barbara to have an airport, and so where to put the airport? Well, there was a group of people that wanted to put an airport on the Mesa, where Shoreline Park is. It was a guy named Captain Lowe, that was his property. So there's a great call to have a Mesa airport. And right after that happened, I have a letter from a realtor offering this woman of Montecito potential to buy this property on before the oil people come, because there was also oil being discovered on the Mesa. And they said, well, before the oil guys get these towers up here, you better buy this property just in time for an airfield. And there were several other people that started calling for an airport on the Mesa, that a Ford Tri-Motor could land there. So this was like 1928. And what I find humorous about this story was, first, this thing was spread where a leading citizen said we should have an airfield because it's going to be a major improvement for the city, and the Mesa is just the proper place to put it. Then we have the realtors all of a sudden moving, trying to sell this property to speculators. And then I found an ad 4 days later, which was for insurance against falling aircraft parts on your house should it be near an airfield.
While many of Santa Barbara's early airfields began on ranches and farms, some aviators took a more impromptu approach to testing their aircraft designs.
Well, he says, we're getting ready to fly this thing. He says, if you're interested, he says, be there at 6 o'clock in the morning on De La Guerra Street in Milpas. And he says, there's a little hill there, and the road goes down De La Guerra Street, down between the dump lots. And he says, we're going to try to fly it there. So I showed up at 6 o'clock, and they were fluttering around this thing, putting gas in it and making sure it run and all stuff. It only had a little small little engine in it, and that was the reason they needed the hill to get it going. See? So they started this thing up and said, okay, stand back now, and they give it a push over the top of the hill. Got it going pretty good, and the darn thing took off. And it was only probably 4 or 5 feet off the ground, but it was flying.
There was another airfield just off of Milpas Street behind the Marmonte Hotel, and some call it the Corona del Mar Airport. And there was a Zenith aircraft company that was building airplanes out there, and so that was their landing field. And I think one or two crashes may have happened, and so that's why that airfield sort of closed up and went down.
One of the fields that was developing early was in Santa Barbara, and three local flyers were not real pleased with that location, and so they got the rights to develop a field here in Goleta, basically southwest of the intersection of Fairview and Hollister Avenues.
It was a deep sea sailing port, and that was in 1860, and Goleta was slated to be the capital of California for a short time because they had the deep water sailing port. And they had timber here to build ships. So all of that looked real good for Goleta. But in 1862, they had 1 month of constant rain, and the whole mountain slid down right over everything, wiped out most of Goleta, and filled up the deepwater sailing port with dirt, which made enough of a runway to run to fly the very first airplanes off of it.
At that time, Goleta was a very small community of a few hundred people. Most of the land was devoted to farms and ranches.
The airport was kind of a country airport then. You know, there's no tower, no nothing, no electronics. Heck, there's only one in five airplanes out there that had a battery or lights or anything. It's really kind of Model T Ford days.
The Goleta Field, sometimes referred as the Goleta Airport, sometimes as the Santa Barbara Airport, was primarily in use as a dairy farm. This presented its own set of challenges to early aviators.
The airport operator says, well, you land on the lawn, but you have to scare the cows away first before you can land, because that was a milk farm where the tower is.
The Goleta Field and the Ovington Field were early competitors, and the Santa Barbara City Council passed an ordinance that basically shut down the Ovington Field because of the air traffic too near residential areas.
In the 1930s, planning director L. Deming Tilton released a report entitled The Santa Barbara Airport Problem. In the report, Deming analyzed each possible airport site, recommending the Goleta Airport location because the Goleta site was far from homes and provided better weather conditions.
Century Pacific was the first commercial airline to come in. That was in, I believe, 1931. They had service to the Bay Area, San Francisco, Los Angeles, San Diego, and Tucson.
The next major tenant at the new airport was the General Western Aero Corporation. Their airplane design was the first to use a metal propeller.
This is a company that began in Burbank in 1930. They liked the Goleta Santa Barbara area. There was this new field in Goleta that had just been started in 1928-29. They built a number of buildings here in Goleta, most significantly two hangars, which survive today. They had several planes that they advertised. Only one really was built in any kind of a quantity, and that was the Meteor, which was a single engine, single wing, two-seat sport plane, basically. Now remember, this is right after the start of the Depression, and so money was very tight, and people were worrying about a lot more things besides, you know, sport aviation, unfortunately for General Western. So as it turned out, they only ended up making just a handful of payments on their lease, maybe 4, 5, 6 months, and they were basically out of money. All of the buildings right there were taken, the General Western buildings, were taken over by the Bundys, Burton and Jesse Bundy, who started their Santa Barbara flying service, and they were doing repair, they were doing flight school, and they lived upstairs in the administration building, which was located in between the two hangars, and they were there for a number of years.
I remember going out there and watching the DC-3 come in and landing on a dirt field. And if you're familiar with the airport, on the northeast corner, there are two hangars, and in between those two hangars was a little tiny shop. You'd think it was a tool shop or something. That was the first office for United Airlines in Santa Barbara, yeah.
Well, United Airlines, and it's kind of its former self, started service at the Santa Barbara Airport, actually before it was the Santa Barbara Airport, in 1936.
This was the big air carrier in the United States, handling about 35% of all of the passenger air travel domestic in the U.S. and about 40% of all of the air mail. They used the hangars. The administration building became their passenger terminal. There wasn't a control tower on the there at the field, and so they added a little control tower on the top of one of the two hangars, spotting tower, I guess it would have been.
pretty soon, passenger air travel really caught on, and they approached, United approached the city about building a terminal at another location on the airport. And the city entered into a lease with them, and United contracted with the architects Edwards and Plunkett, and they designed a small Spanish colonial revival building that was the original terminal, and then of course over the years it was added on to. Finally, in 1941, there was a bond issue presented to the voters.
The community voted, and the headline said 10,000 people to vote, and the bond issue was $149,000, which seems awfully cheap to me now, but I mean it was way back when, 1941 I think. So they did, and the community purchased the land for their designated as a Santa Barbara airport.
It was Mayor Patrick Marr who was instrumental in getting the bond measure passed. And in recognition of his contribution, the city dedicated a plaque in his honor, which now stands in front of the new airline terminal.
And then, of course, simultaneously, the U.S. entered into World War II, and they were looking for bases on the coasts.
Right after Pearl Harbor, basically, Goleta was identified as, you know, a good location for a Marine base, and that started that entire development. And it basically took over the, you know, essentially all of the airport operation, buildings on the you know, where UCSB is now, additional, you know, lots of buildings on the north side of Hollister, and of course, you know, quite a bit on the airport property as well. With the creation of the Marine base, suddenly we've got a much greater demand for flying and especially for landing. And so the airport was dramatically increased in size at that point. One of the very unfortunate results of that was removal of a huge portion of the Chumash Indian village on Musculatin Island.
Phil Orr, who was our curator of anthropology here at the museum, went out and did archaeological excavations. And we can tell from the work that he did back in the 1940s that the town was occupied as early as 2,000 years ago. There were actually four Chumash towns around the Goleta Lagoon, one of which was on the island, Musculatin Island. And the name of that town, by the way, was Halo. There was another name also that was recorded for the island called Hua. And that name actually appears in Cabrillo's account in 1542. So Cabrillo had been given that name and several other names around the Goleta Valley back in 1542. Apparently the towns had different names, you know, several centuries before the first Spanish land expedition arrived. Really, if you look at the population along the Santa Barbara Channel, all the way from Point Conception, you know, down to Ventura, and then you look at the population on the Channel Islands and the San Ynez Valley, one of the most central places is the Goleta Valley. So, you know, trade routes and trade had to funnel through that area. And so the Goleta towns were really optimally situated to participate in this regional trade system. There have been several different archaeological projects since that have resulted in further investigations on the island. Really, those collections that have come from those excavations have informed us about changes through time in Chumash culture. And in particular, the beads and ornaments, you know, that have been found during the different excavations have been useful to work out the whole sequence of change. And so when you study the changes in beads and ornaments, you're also studying the changes in the political economy of Chumash society. So the Musculatin Islands has played a big role in understanding these changes.
Yesterday, December 7th, 1941, a date which will live in infamy.
December 7th, Day of Infamy, the Japanese bomb Pearl Harbor 1941. In February 1942, a submarine surfaces at Elwood and shells the oil facilities there. So America is feeling, you know, vulnerable that these submarines can just come right up and attack our Pacific West Coast.
We wanted something close to the ocean. We needed something that was a port, and we needed someplace where there was a population that could support the base also. So Santa Barbara appeared to be in an ideal position to do that.
They used some 10 to 12 feet of fill to fill in the slough where the air base is. So you can imagine how big that Miskeleton Island originally was, and there was just a mere stub of it was left when they were done. And so tens of thousands of years of Chumash Indian occupation was erased shovel by shovel, blade by blade. But back then they didn't think about that. The island had been excavated several times by archaeologists, so I guess they figured, okay, what was found was found. The war effort is the most important thing, so we're gonna have to level the island.
They paved over and they filled in the Goleta tidal basin. But the way they did it, for every 1,000 feet there was a 6-inch drop, so it was not very much of a drop or an elevation of the airport before when they started. And so it would flood quite often. And when the high tides would come in, it would start to fill up the runways. And one of the runways was not usable.
And the marine aviators used to call it the swamp, or they called it Lake Santa Barbara, because as soon as it rained, everything was underwater.
It was quite difficult to get around it from time to time. They had to drive around in jeeps all the time and through the mud, so.
And to make matters worse, just across the street along the other side of South Fairview was a farm and slaughterhouse. It didn't smell too good, and then it was this whole swamp type thing. The base was commissioned on St. Barbara's Day in December of 1942.
Housed here were, at its peak, were 500 Marine officers, 3,100 Marine enlisted men. We had 440 women Marines and approximately 330 civilians that were aboard also.
Popular perception of Goleta as the location for the Marine base is also depicted in the 1951 Warner Brothers movie starring John Wayne, The Flying Leathernecks.
I have a station job at Goleta.
A station job? Oh, what a beautiful sob. And Goleta? That beautiful, hot, dirty little town. Probably have to live on the wrong side of the track.
On the north side of Hollister, you can see some of the old buildings from the Marine Air Corps Station that are there. Well, Hollister was the main highway coming through Santa Barbara. And even though there was gas rationing and, you know, war shortages, the traffic was still some 7,000 cars a day were passing through Santa Barbara. Well, every time they had to move airplanes and personnel across, they had to shut down the entire highway and get everything across. You know, open up the highway, and this would happen several times a day.
Their machine shops, their fuel tanks, that kind of thing. So taxiing across Hollister Avenue, or the state highway at the time, to the maintenance facilities on the other side of the airport. They had a propeller shop over there. They had a parachute packing building. So they had a lot of that type of activity going on. And then the airfield, of course, was the storage or parking of the aircraft and the flying, of course. And then the UCSB was the housing and recreation facilities.
There was 23 fighter squadrons that were trained. There was 14 torpedo bomber squadrons, and there was 6 scout bomber squadrons that were trained.
At the mess hall, you would have a daily schedule that was posted for you to, whether it be flying, whether it be recognition, whether it be shooting, whatever, you know, it'd be that kind of thing. And so you were kept pretty busy.
Their training would consist of normal flight operations, would consist of fighter engagement, how to do it in pairs, how to protect each other, the various tactics on how to fight in the air, air to air, how to do bombing and that type of thing. The torpedo squadrons would practice their torpedo drops.
And we'd bomb the rocks up off of Point Conception. We had targets on the other side of the island, and we'd bomb those. And we'd use water bombs at that time. They were just fake bombs that we dropped, 100-pound bombs, or 400 or 500-pound bombs. They'd send one dive bomber up with a target
a trailing target. You've seen those, I'm sure. And in an SBD or a dive bomber, they had a 30 caliber machine gun. They would paint the tips of the bullets that dip the belts of shells into the paint. Everybody had different color. You know, one guy'd have red, another guy'd have blue, and so forth. And what they'd do, the target plane would fly straight and level. But the other planes would dive past the target, and you'd have to shoot at it as you went by, or they'd come up this way, and you'd have to shoot at it as you went back up. And you had to get so many hits on a target before you were over your training. And it was kind of tough to do.
These guys had to be able to maneuver quite well with these planes to do dive bombing, because that was straight at a ship and everybody was going to shoot at you. So, and then to skip along the waves to launch a torpedo took a certain amount of bravery, because you didn't have a hell of a lot of error if you were suddenly hit a downdraft.
But they had a large crane built at Goleta Pier where they put a hulk of an airplane. I think it was an Avenger. And the pilots and the crew would get into that airplane with all their gear, and they would drop the airplane into the water. And they had 60 seconds to be able to deploy their life vests and get out of the airplane and get to the surface.
My commanding officer was a guy by the name, he was a captain, Captain Barry was his name. Everybody liked him. He had bad eyes, actually. You know, if they'd have known he was wearing glasses for strikes, again, you might think. But anyway, when he'd come out to get in his plane, he'd have his glasses on with his goggles pulled down over them so nobody would know he had his glasses on. But he was a jovial, kind of plump, kind of a real nice guy. He really was. To everybody, you know, it didn't matter whether you were enlisted or an officer, he was the same way.
But it was a huge enterprise. There was torpedo bomber squadrons. There was the fighter planes. And then you think of what it takes to train all these guys. So what is now UCSB was the camp for all these people. And they spent some $10 million. So think what that did to Santa Barbara's economy, having all that money spent here.
I don't know whether you guys knew about Mom's Italian Village down on Cota Street, did you? Well, I used to take my girl down there for a spaghetti dinner or whatever. But no guy in uniform ever paid the bill in there. You'd walk in and it kind of kept you away from there, because you didn't want her to be paying for your dinner all the time, you know. But she would. If you'd go in there, even with a girl, it would be free.
You know, being along the West Coast, having been attacked at Elwood one time, having Japanese submarine sightings from time to time along the coast, the people here were very, very glad to have the Marines and that air and that protection available to them in the area.
This whole nation of 130 million free men and women and children is becoming one great fighting force.
I can tell you about my wife's family. She had cousins and uncles and aunts here in town. The strange thing about that, after that shelling, it scared those people so bad that they would all get together on Sunday night and have dinner. They were, you know, they all got, instead of staying away from each other, they all came together. That kind of surprised me. I'm sure it shook the people up in Santa Barbara. That was just proof of it to me. I met my wife at the First Presbyterian Church downtown. I went to a dance here at the base one Saturday night, and she happened to be some of the women that came in to the dance. So I saw her there again, and then we started going together and went together for the rest of the time I was here. We wrote each other when I was overseas, she had our wedding set up as soon as I got back. I got back on November 6th of 1945, we were married on November 18th, so she wasn't going to let me get away, I guess.
At one point in time, Marine Air Group 24, the first one that was here, had the 24 performed 24 marriage ceremonies in one day with the citizens of Santa Barbara.
Listen, you cowboys, you just put your money down. I'll cover anything from even money to 4-1.
One of the famed squadrons that was at the Marine Corps Air Base was the Black Sheep Squadron. And I'm sure most of us will remember Robert Conrad playing Pappy Boyington and the hard scrabble aviators of the Black Sheep Squadron. They came back at one point from their South Pacific efforts to reorganize, get reacquainted. Also, Santa Barbara was a rehabilitation center. The Navy, the Marines, and the Army had all taken over the major hotels. And so soldiers and people coming back from usually the South Pacific theater got to spend 2 weeks here in luxury at one of our fine hotels. When they came to Santa Barbara, though, their famed leader, Pappy Boyington, was not with them. He had been lost in action. They thought he was killed, but actually he was a prisoner of war.
They flew F-4Us, Corsairs, and they were kind of a nutsy group, but they were the kind of guys that didn't care whether they lived or died, I thought.
VMF 214 was here at one time training and then deployed back out to aboard the CVEs again. As a matter of fact, we knew a Marine aviator that lived in Carpinteria that passed away a couple years ago. That was a member of that Black Sheep Squadron and would come and talk to us and tell us stories about those characters and what they did. The need was for Marine aviators to provide close air support during amphibious operations. The only way we could do that is to deploy now on aboard aircraft carriers. So there was a specific aircraft carrier called an Essex class, and it was a support carrier. And that's where the Marines deployed aboard those carriers as they went through. And all the training to go aboard those CVEs happened right here at the Marine Corps Air Station Goleta.
They put a carrier deck on the runway, and those guys had to take off within the length that they had. You know, you don't always have the full deck because there's planes on the fantail, so you've got whatever deck's there to take off of, and that's what they had to learn.
And they had a tail hook to work off of, so they practiced both the landing and takeoffs.
If you can imagine being shot off at from a standing stop to about 75 miles an hour, 75, 80 miles an hour. It's just a jolt and you're in the air, that's all. You're there, it just throws you back and you're there. You're flying. Landing would depend on the condition of the ocean at the time when you were landing. The carrier would turn into the wind, which was done to slow you down as you came in. The tough part about it, if the sea was rough, was if you happened to be coming down and the ship happened to be coming up, and both, it's a controlled crash of what it is. Actually, that's exactly what it is. It's a controlled crash. I've always likened it to going on a roller coaster. The first time you ever do it, you're excited about it, and it is kind of it's something new and it's exciting and it's scary, you know. But after you do it if you ride a roller coaster 10 times, it gets easy to do, you know. In the same way with flying off a carrier, it's a little thrill. It doesn't matter when you do it, it's always a little thrill to take off. You know, it's possible for your engine to fail too, you know. And so you have a few worries, but it is because you're running your engine at full blast, and if it fails, you've had it. That's all there is to it. One night we were up for division tactics, and we were taking off out over Santa Barbara, and we got out over the islands, and we just about caught the other planes, and the pilots started leaning out. They were coming back in over the base, and the pilot or started towards the base. The pilot was leaning out the engine and leaning out the fuel, and the engine quit. And so at night, that's kind of harrowing, believe me. Two balls of fire flew by me, and it backfired, and two balls of fire flew by me, and it just quit, and we started down, and he pushed it up to full rich, the engine, the feed up to full rich, and it caught again. And he called the tower and he landed downwind on the runway he had taken off this way, coming back in. That was a little bit of a shock, but and that happened again once more overseas when we were up on SUP patrol. We were out about 50 miles ahead of the ship. We used to fly quadrants in the front, in the bow of the ship, and quadrants in the rear of the ship. And we were out about 50 miles ahead of the ship, and he was leaning it out again, and it happened again. That's worse, believe me. Out of my squadron, there were four crews that never made it back. They were all either shot down or had to crash land, you know, and that was the end of them. But things happen. One of them was right behind us one day in a dive and got his wing shot off. And so they're gone, you know, and that's it. Just that fast. By the time I got back from overseas, I was 21. That was about the average age for guys that were in the service. Some of them were a little bit older, some of them a little bit younger even. Once in a while, you'd see a kid that was 18. You know, I've seen some of these kids that flew in heavy bombers over in Germany. They're just kids. They were like me. They had gone through gunnery school, and that's where they were, you know, in airplanes. I wish I could answer that question. I don't know. Luck, maybe. I guess I used to wonder about that once in a while, but I can't answer it. I don't know. I went through as much as they went through, so and practically everything that they went through.
Captain Frederick Lopez, whose the street was named after, that's right in front of the drive-in off of Hollister Avenue, Frederick P. Lopez, he was a captain in the United States Army. He was an engineer by billet, by trade. He was killed over in the Eastern Theater in April of 1945. He was my dad's best friend throughout grade school and through high school. And I was named after him when I was born, about a month and a half later after he died.
There are more aviators that died during World War II than there are streets on the airport. And really that's how we came to do our World War II memorial on the airport a few years ago, and listed additional people who didn't have a street named after them.
It was kind of emotional because I was very proud that we were able to do that, and very thankful that for the families particularly that were in the audience, that they actually got to go up to the memorial and touch it and touch their aviator's name. And I felt good that long after I'm gone from working at the airport, that regardless of what happens to the street names, that those aviators will be remembered. Several veterans organizations got together. They solicited suggestions from the community, who should these streets be named after, and people submitted their names of individuals who they thought should be have a street name. And then the veterans organizations voted on it, and because there were only 25 streets, so they voted on the 25 people, local aviators that died during World War II, to be on the street names.
We were headed out for the invasion of Japan, and just about that time when they dropped the atomic bomb. And we were cruising around out there, and finally our orders came that we were to go to Formosa and pick up the prisoners that were in the prisoner camp there, the guys that had been taken at Crigador and Bataan.
We had two prisoners of war, and their stories were, to me, heartbreaking. Cecil Cook was captured and a prisoner of war from the Philippines, and he was put on a Japanese POW ship. And often those ships were could be private, like cruise line boats or military boats, but they weren't labeled. There were was no identification on them. And his ship ended up being shot by an American ship. And it was sunk, and then as people jumped off of the ship, the Japanese shot them. So, you know, there were some survivors, but not many, and Cecil Cook was not one of them. I felt that was just a tragic story. And then the other was Robert Newman, and he was a pilot stationed in the Philippines, and he was captured and was in the Bataan Death March and did not make it through to the other end and died during the march.
When we brought these guys aboard, they hadn't had any food, you know, any decent food for 3 years. They had the mess hall set up 24 hours for them. They'd go in and eat and go out and throw it up and then go back and eat again.
When we were researching the names for the memorial is when Betty's name first came up. And to have a young girl killed in the war, you know, she was as a pilot, apparently, from what I've heard and read, created quite a stir here about that type of situation.
I was traveling in Europe a couple years ago. I went to the D-Day celebration on D-Day and toured the D-Day battlegrounds, and then I toured the rest of some of the other battle sites. And it was amazing as you go through Belgium and France, the Normandy part of France, and other countries, all the monuments that are there, where this city was saved, these people did this, the Army did this, the Air Force did this. It's amazing all the tributes and how they honor Americans. We don't see that much in the United States because not that many cities and towns had an opportunity to do what Santa Barbara did along the way, but you don't see that. And I think that history needs to be preserved. I think our people need to know what sacrifice and what happened and the patriotism and what they did for the war effort. We wanted to honor the Marine Corps Air Station, all the Marines and all the civilians and all of the other services that served here, because it was such an iconic location and because of the mission that this Santa Barbara Airport provided. It's going to be a piece of art, and as a piece of art it's intended to make people think and be able to see different things that other people won't see. So people will have different interpretations of what they see. They'll look at it, they'll see the Marine Corps emblem, hopefully they'll stop and see the story of what it's about, and so we hope their interpretation of what they see is something that shows patriotism, sacrifice, honor, and just honor to the ghosts of those that were here at one time. And we hope we make them think and give thanks to the people and all of our wonderful citizens that served during World War II, and especially those who died.
The Marine Air Base was given back to the community after World War II. The airport grew slowly through the 1950s. Commercial traffic was sparse. Individuals continued to fly and teach others.
Right after the war, I guess the GIs could learn to fly, and I think they could even go up through a commercial rating. And there were a lot of little flying schools.
I would go out there once in a while and watch to look at these airplanes, because as a kid you weren't allowed to get in them or on them, and you see them take off and landing. So it was just kind of exciting and made me dream of flying someday.
Mrs. Parsons and I were good friends, and her son, Louis, was in the military and was away, and he had three or four airplanes that he has at that airport. Mrs. Parsons was always responsible for keeping the airplanes exercised, and that's important for an aircraft to be exercised while he was serving in the service. And I got to ride along with some of the fellows that came down and exercised the airplanes, and she just decided that I enjoyed it so much that I should learn how to fly, so she brought me out to the Santa Barbara Airport to the Santa Barbara Flying Club meeting. They used to have meetings in this building. And so I was signed up, joined the club, and got an instructor, got a student permit all that night, and I started flying the next day.
But there were a lot of individuals that had airplanes. I mean, fuel was 29 cents a gallon back then, and so it didn't cost you a fortune to fly. In those days, there was no tie-down fee. You could park anywhere on the airport for free and pull up to the restaurant or control tower and go in, talk to the weather guys, or there was no restrictions.
And then there was another fellow named Leon Durden, and he was a fish spotter, but first when he worked for Santa Barbara Flying Service, he was the one that was my instructor for commercial rating. That's when I really learned how to fly.
Leon Durden was a developed fish spotting out of Santa Barbara, and used to go out and spot fish from his airplane at night and radio to the fishermen in the boat so they could go and catch the fish.
Well, back in those days, you either had a radio with one channel or you used flashing lights out of the tower, which was pretty much the normal in those days. They'd give you a flashing green where you were okay to land, or a steady red if it wasn't clear to land and circle the airport.
When I was a young kid, there were two big treats in my life, and that was to go drive out to the airport, which of course was almost a cross-country trip in those days, or go to the railroad station and watch trains. So the airport thing stuck better than the train. Everybody remembers the wall that later had a glass partition on top of it, but that's the wall. And I'm the person sitting there with his feet over the other side, and the fellow in the overcoat is my grandfather, and that's about 1949. So I was 3 at the time.
When I first got my license, the airport was just Santa Barbara Airport. You didn't have the Federal Aviation Administration there. And it was sometime before they did. As private aviation built up, more and more people had airplanes. Traffic got thicker and thicker. But in addition to that, you had commercial airplanes coming in. And the FAA felt it was time to control that air traffic to avoid accidents.
I had to be one of the boys. No, there was maybe one other woman pilot that I knew of at the time.
Around that time, we had runway lights that they turned on when you called and let them know you wanted to land. We didn't have taxiway lights per se like they have now. The airport guards used to have to drive up and down the runways, hang out of their car, and lean out and switch the runway lights on. And that was, you know, Bakersfield had runway and taxi lights long before we did here.
The security issue was basically nil. I'm sure you could walk out and meet somebody at the airplane. It was fairly casual. And of course, that flying was treated in a much different way in those days. It was kind of special. People dressed to go flying, you know, women in skirts and gloves even. You see the old photos and it's always fun to look at. It wasn't the normal thing. I mean, flying's become a commodity and it wasn't then.
The Flightline restaurant was the local hangout, and a lot of people used to go there. I used to go there and have turkey sandwiches all the time with my dad, Leon Durden, and my dad and I used to go to lunch there all the time. And of course, Evie was one of the waitresses, and she always wanted to ride in Dad's jet. And she told that my dad one time, she said, "If you don't give me a ride in that jet, I'm going to go out there and lay down on the taxiway, so you'll have to give me a ride, but you won't be able to get out of the hangar."
Jack Conroy and his group used to come in. One of Lockheed's test pilots, Fish Herman Salmon. Fish was his nickname. Clay Lacy, aviation out of Los Angeles, now a Van Nuys airport. Willie Shoemaker, the jockey, came in one time.
That was what we called our best watering hole. And that's where we got together. Art Snyder had a round table inside the restaurant, and you know, we just kind of would meet there and talk, course, fly around a little bit inside the restaurant.
Kirk Douglas and Michael were sitting just at the next table from the round table. And one of the ladies at the round table said to my friend Jan, she whispered, "Do you see Kirk Douglas?" And Jan raises her head and looks around. She said, "Where's Kirk Douglas?" "I don't see Kirk Douglas," in her normal voice. He goes and he waves at her, and I thought, ugh.
It was a good place to socialize and talk about the day flying, or talk about the weather, or talk about the crashes, whatever.
I don't know, I think it was the atmosphere of people like to watch airplanes because they taxied right up to the windows practically. And you could see runway 25 from the inside of the restaurant. And of course the pilots, it was a good place for them to come to. They could use the phone to call and open and close their flight plans. Everybody was very friendly. And then of course with the Santa Barbara Aviation was right there. At one time they had started what they called University of the Air. And so we got a lot of young people looking to get their airline transport rating, and the Santa Barbara Aviation set them up in apartments, etc. And so we got people from all over the world coming here. I loved working there, except during the road races.
Back in the 50s, they used to have car races on the airport property. And my grandfather, who was associated with farming here in the Goleta Valley, he would rent bales of hay, for the races.
One of the clubs here in town put on these sports car road races. And the old Flightline restaurant was right in the middle of the pit area. So from 8 o'clock in the morning, there were all these people in and out of the restaurant. Well, Art would not hire any extra help. I was the busboy, I was the waitress, and I was the cashier.
The starting line was kind of out on this ramp out here, and then they went around up one of the runways and around a few of the buildings, came by the hangar, came down this road, and out back to the starting line or finish.
The road races, which went from about 53 through the mid 60s. It was interesting. It was the longest series race like that in the United States at the time. And it raised a lot of money for the community because you could get thousands of people to drive up from the LA area in those days to see something automotive like that.
I was working for the Bundys for the Santa Barbara Flying Service, and they had the whole north side of the airport, leased. And we cracked the hangar doors open and watched the cars go right by.
A new upstart actor from Hollywood drove in one of the sports car races held at Santa Barbara Airport on Memorial Day 1955.
Mom, a kid was killed tonight.
This is all going too fast
for
me.
You better give me something.
The actor was James Dean. He had just wrapped his second movie, Rebel Without a Cause, and was about to make Giant with Elizabeth Taylor. He was vying to place in the race's finalist group and pushed his Porsche 350 Speedster to the limits. He started in the 18th position, worked his way up to fourth before over-revving his engine and blowing a piston. He did not finish the race. The car of the race's winner, however, caught his eye. It was a Porsche 550 Spyder. James Dean traded in his Speedster and paid an extra $3,000 for the Porsche Spyder. After the wrap of the production of Giant, Dean took his new Porsche on a test drive heading up to a race in Salinas. Tragically, James Dean died in a head-on collision near the junctions of Routes 41 and 46. Santa Barbara was to be his last race.
Part of the history was that some locals, several of who are still around town, came up with this idea of having, it's hard to come up with a word, I don't know if the drag race had even been coined yet.
There was a little strip that went from the west end of the airport where the maintenance yard is now, and it went across up towards the college, and it was just a little narrow, I don't know how you could barely get two cars beside each other on it, but they they started that, and Nobody went off the edge that I can remember, but it was pretty scary.
They came up with the thing of running for a quarter of a mile, which became the world standard for a drag race. But it was simply the fact that that's as far as they could go before they had to start slowing down or they were going to run out of road. So it was very arbitrary, but it stuck as the standard.
It was just a bunch of old street rods back in those days. A lot of old Ford V8 engines and nothing super fancy. No comparison to what drag races are now. It was just guys having fun.
As aviation continued to grow, the possibilities for the development of the airport as a viable commercial enterprise floundered under bureaucratic negligence. Though many in Santa Barbara desired changes at the airport, the vision and will for change fell on the shoulders of one man.
He was so brilliant and such a visionary in so many ways that he would look at what was really good for the community. He was a native son. His family went all the way back to the Presidio. I think he had great pride in his community and knew that it was different.
Wonderful guy. I think everybody that knew him had great respect for him. He was not an extrovert, very quiet man, very thoughtful and perceptive.
The development of Santa Barbara Airport into a modern and efficient facility for the stimulation of tourism and high-tech business was an integral part in Rickard's vision for Santa Barbara. But the ability of the city of Santa Barbara to develop the airport faced roadblock after roadblock. The solution that opened the way for airport development, ironically, stemmed from Rickard's preservation efforts to stop development of a different kind.
He wanted to protect Santa Barbara from oil well development like he had in the Summerland and other places. Then well out here toward Gaviota, they got a prescribed 3-mile limit out there that ran from Goleta to Montecito, and that became a protected area against oil drilling. Became part of the city. So later on, with that being part of the city, hey, that's our land, so it goes up to the airport, so that makes us contiguous. So they ran a strip of land under the water out to the airport and back to the airport and annexed that.
This 3-mile tideland sanctuary was to play a pivotal role for the city of Santa Barbara when the need for airport expansion and improvement became obvious.
He realized where we really want to go for Santa Barbara when we get bigger and have more people come here, that why don't we plan for what industry we're going to have here? After World War II, all the new improvements and developments in aviation were coming to the fore. We had much larger planes, now the jet planes were out there. And our airport, even though it was a good airport built up when the Marines were finished with it, it was not large enough or it didn't have the right configuration to handle those planes. We had to make those changes. Everything looks pretty good, except that that land owned by the city is in the county. So it's not actually contiguous, it's not actually within the city limits. And the city doesn't have any control of when it wants to make improvements on the airport because it's in the county.
So Jack went to the Board of Supervisors with the plan for the airport, hoping they would take it on. And they said, no dice. In fact, he came back and he says, they almost laughed me out of the chamber.
From time to time, he had problems with the supervisors for whatever they wanted to do at the airport. That's pretty much where it got started, I think. They wanted to upgrade the place for jet service, and I think that might be where they wanted to start with a bigger terminal. They were always nixed by the supervisors.
For some reason, the county was not interested in accommodating that. They were not interested in having the airport made. So first the city thought, well, if we can't be in charge of it, we'll get some other entity to do it. So they went to the Goleta schools that said, you know, we're not in a position of running this airport. They also went to the Goleta water, Goleta sewage, and of course the county trying to get some other legal entity to take possession of this airport and then to work on this. Nobody wanted to have this. So now this meant the city must figure out some way to make this part of its property.
Several plans were considered that had the city acquiring land in order to connect the city limits to the airport property, including annexing part of Los Padres National Forest. None of these plans proved feasible.
It was Tom Cleveland, who was a reporter at the Santa Barbara News Press, said, you know, if not by land, what about by sea? So the powers that be were all spreading it around, what about the ocean? And they look out to the ocean from the city of Santa Barbara, and along the coastline was a 3-mile sanctuary created by then Mayor Rickard.
Having got the tidelands in, which was about a 3-mile strip going out and straight down the coast, it was controlled by the city. So his feeling was that he could not just control it, but use it as a vector to get over to the airport and get it in.
After years of legal wrangling, lawsuits against it, and the failure of the city's case in appeals court, the plan to annex the tidelands into the city of Santa Barbara was defeated.
Once it was originally turned down, kind of gave up on it. You had to be dedicated to the fact that this was, you could get this done somehow, and you had to have a legal mind to do it.
City attorney at that time was Stan Tomlinson, and he was going up to Larcotta Court when down from his office comes John Rickard, and Stan is reporting on what in the world are we going to do. We have the recent ruling, the court turned down our appeal to overturn the previous court. We don't have access to the airport. How are we going to do this? We're going to lose that airport. And Jack Rickard said, you know, I think as I was told, if not by land, by sea, you got to go back into the ocean.
I don't know how they figured that was going to work any better than, well, if you can't use the whole tidelands, how can you use 3 feet? But apparently it was nothing but legal jargon. They just deciphered what was in the law and found that this was something that was not explicitly denied. So if you can't deny it, you got to accept it.
Then it was contested in the courts, and the courts went along with Jack Rickard's position. But subsequently, the state legislature said, hey, wait a minute, we can't allow that. So they changed the law. So we got underneath, you might say, the threshold there.
He chuckled a lot when they found out that right after we finished doing that, they closed the loophole. They wouldn't let it happen again.
In 2013, in recognition of Rickard's lifetime of contribution, the new airline terminal was named the John T. Rickard Terminal. With the airport now under the control of the city, the 1960s and 70s saw a colorful array of new businesses, new airline companies, visits by presidents, heads of state, and kings and queens. The airport also became home to one of aviation's most unusual and useful endeavors.
Jack Conroy, he was, the president of Aerospace Lines, a new company. He liked Santa Barbara, and so it was his idea to move the whole operation to Santa Barbara, and which was highly unadvisable according to everybody else because of the fact that it was so remote from Burbank and so on where the labor pool was. But that didn't stop Jack. He dragged us up here.
We used to go to the ends of the runway and watch the jets take off and land. And we were always fascinated by the guppies. I remember when, you know, the first one arrived. That was always something of great fascination to everyone, how they looked and how they were made from, you know, pieces of other planes.
I heard it was coming in, but I didn't even know what it was. And it came in and landed, and it was just a magnificent thing. It's huge. It shouldn't be flying. It's like a bumblebee.
You could see it coming from way down by Ventura, and it looked like a big blimp or a big whale coming towards you.
The weirdest part about the guppy was watching it land, because it didn't land normal like most aircraft where the nose is up a little bit. It's almost like a flat landing.
When it came to building the guppy, it wasn't really his idea. He was sitting in one of the bars in Van Nuys, and somebody mentioned that there was no way that they had to move the Saturn missiles. They were too wide to go on a train. They couldn't put them on a ship because it'd be destroyed by the salt air. Couldn't put them on a truck. So now that they built them, they couldn't move them. So he said, the same guy said, gee, I don't know why somebody doesn't just build an airplane big enough to take it. The airplane was big enough to swallow a Saturn missile, and that was why they built the airplane. They shove the missile in, fly the missile to whatever site it had to go for its launch. Then they'd fly back, get another missile, and do the same thing. So the airplanes are shuffling back and forth to these missile sites.
He made it all happen against all odds, and he had a really good product for the time. And it can't be underestimated the impact it had on the space program, because it was pretty monumental.
Warner von Braun stated that it was the best piece of equipment that he had to get the men onto the moon.
They had it filled with bags of flour, I think it was. And in a dive test, the upper portion above the cockpit wasn't structured quite strong enough, and it caved in, and then suddenly they had flour all over. It was sort of a chaos, especially the way it opened up. You know, it opened up in the front, if I remember right. Kind of swung out and weird. But just took someone like Conroy to do it.
We used the Guppy several times when we built a full-size engineering unit of the Mobile Lunar Laboratory, which was, as I said, an 8,000-pound big vehicle. When we delivered it to NASA, we used the Guppy. Drove right into the Guppy, and then they flew it to Huntsville, Alabama.
Well, there were no facilities for us until the airport moved those old warehouse buildings for us.
They were actually built for aerospace lines, but they were built for maintenance and repair of large aircraft, and of course that's where they started repairing and took the initial airplane and made it the Guppy for air cargo.
They started building the number 3 Guppy here in Santa Barbara about the time I graduated from high school, and my father was friendly with the people that were working on it. And he said, hey, you know, if you need some help, my son would come out here and just do cleanup work for you. And they said, oh, well, send him out and apply for a job. So I went out there and applied for a job with a man by the name of Maurice Aysen. And he was a German designer and very capable airplane builder and modifier. And so I went to work there as a sheet metal mechanics assistant. And the majority of my job for the first few months consisted of just bucking rivets, which is you're holding a steel bar on the other side of the aircraft, and there's a technician on the other side that's shooting the rivet with an air gun. And we built the whole number 3 Guppy, which was called the Mini Guppy. It was the first wide floor Guppy, and it was built on Hollister Avenue, right across the street from them where the E-bar is. The part that surprised me the most was how they went about the work. You would think it would be more organized, or that it would be more done in a big factory. But essentially, they took this airplane and they taxied it across the street to the north side, where the big hangar is on the north side of Hollister Avenue. They taxied that airplane over there and set it up on jack stands and proceeded to just cut it apart. And we proceeded to just modify it right there. It basically in an uncovered area. Later on, they came along and they built a superstructure over it to protect us from the rain during the winter. There was very little stuff that we had to work with, and we managed to modify that complete airplane, and it was very amazing to see what they accomplished with so little.
I remember on the Turbo 3, Conroy was, of course, flying it, and he feathered the two outboard engines and was just flying across with the nose engine. And I could probably almost see his smile from the ground.
That was a wonderful era. There were a lot of things going on at this airport at that time.
He's got about two wheels on the ground. He's a big rooster tail out of all four wheels.
The space program brought many innovative businesses to the Santa Barbara Airport, including the Lunar Rover, developed by General Motors Engineering Director Frank Pavlicks.
To begin with, the temperature range between night and day is from minus 250 degrees F to plus 250. Besides, there is total vacuum on the moon. There is no atmosphere. And then the gravity is only 1/6 of Earth gravity. So all these conditions had to be considered in designing such a moon operating vehicle.
NASA first contracted with General Motors to design, build, and test an entire mobile laboratory for lunar exploration. The large 8,000-pound pressurized vehicle was designed to accommodate two astronauts for 14 days.
The problem was that it would have required a separate Saturn V launch rocket. So they would send the Apollo spacecraft with the two people on. Then they would have to send up this vehicle right next to them so they can then use it for exploration. Now NASA found out that they don't have the money. So they canceled that MOLAB project after we already developed and built full-size test vehicles, which they actually tested in the Mojave Desert. And they gave up on vehicles on the moon altogether. The scientific community, of course, wanted to explore the moon and do some geological surveys and go far away from where they landed. So they were pushing for a mobility for the astronauts. And we at General Motors Research, we followed up on this possibility and came up with a concept which could be compatible with the already designed lunar lander. With this idea, where the vehicle would have been folded together to fit a very small corner of the lunar lander, that was one of the biggest problems. It's involved something like putting a jeep-sized vehicle into the back of a station wagon. So we took this model to Huntsville, Alabama, where the NASA Center was located. And after our presentations, the engineers there suggested to show it to von Braun. By remote control, I guided the vehicle into his office, right to his desk. And he was on the telephone at the time. He was watching this little thing coming in without seeing anybody else. And finally he took down the phone, got up, we came into his office and then explained about the whole concept, how is it possible to do, how it folds up. And he came very excited about it. And a few months later, we received a contract to design, develop, and build these lunar rovers.
I know there was a lunar landscape out behind their building that you could see when you flew over it. It was very amusing. It was a carved bit of land that you think, oh, look, lunar landscape.
So we could use that as a small training facility, craters and hills and boulders and so on. But for larger training, we took them out to Pismo Beach.
And that was another thing, that was in another era. The whole NASA thing was going on simultaneously, so it brought us the Guppy, it brought us that, it brought a lot of people that were very technically oriented into aviation.
We were one of the first organization who started this before Hughes came out for the Santa Barbara Research Organization, and then Raytheon set up their organization. And eventually the GM Research Lab became known as Delco Operations.
Modifications, maintenance, engineering, and manufacturing.
In 1981, Tracor Aviation took up shop in the 200,000-square-foot hangar and office space vacated by Aerospace Lines. The hangar, originally built to house the Guppy, was large enough for Tracor's main business, refurbishing and repairing large commercial aircraft. The highly skilled Tracor maintenance team worked on jets of every size, ranging from DC-8s to 747s. When it came to takeoffs and landings, the larger jets proved to be a challenge for Santa Barbara Airport's small runway.
When Tracor was operating as a full FAA repair station, maintenance and repair station, then the 747s would fly in and land because they were empty. But as soon as they touched down, they would cut the engines that were on the outside, the furthest ones out. So therefore, the vortex didn't happen to affect the signage on the runway. On takeoff, however, once they were ready to go, they gave us an hour's notice, and maintenance would go out and take those signs down for the first half of the runway, because when they took off, they had to have all four engines going because of the length of the runway and the size of the aircraft, and the wings literally are wider than the width of the runway. So they were hanging over, and the signs literally would be clipped and just sent like little tornadoes off. So we always had to do that. But you know, the big guy would take off about the parallels and it would just creep up and go. It was gorgeous, just absolutely gorgeous. Now, when they did the DC-10s, you know, with the tail and the engine in the tail, we had to stop traffic on Fairview because of the dust and the debris that would flow back over, so we couldn't have bicyclists or cars being damaged from the takeoff. They provided more than 1,000 jobs here in Goleta, and drew upon the expertise of all of the aviation and companies like Raytheon and those companies for positions. But they had full engineering services. They even had a machine shop. They had a paint shop, interior design and redoing all of the aircraft. So it really was good for the airport.
During the late 1980s, Tracor operated 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. Tracor Aviation, a major presence at the airport for a decade, closed its doors permanently in March 1991. It was the end of a truly unique decade. While innovative businesses continued to expand at the airport and nearby, the airport infrastructure struggled to keep up.
Atrocious, for lack of a better word. It was built back in the 50s, and it reflected that. We had major leaks. Air conditioning problems, heating problems, equipment failures. The city of Santa Barbara, which was the airport proprietor, actually owned the old tower. And they were trying to upkeep it to maintain the safety standards that we required.
The airport runways were also in transition.
They had a pretty good sized jet that came in all the time, because I worked on the airport crew in the summer of 1965 or 66. And they were constantly trying to get the runway to handle the weight. This thing was actually denting the runway, it was so heavy. So they started pouring big patches of concrete, you know, concrete 12 inches thick, and after a while it worked. But that's kind of the nuts and bolts transition from regular propeller traffic to jet traffic.
It had been raining, and the creek had backed up, and I decided to come out early to find out if we were really going to open or not, because, you know, our prime concern was safety of the controllers and the technicians also. We got here, there were already a couple of controllers came in early on their own to staff up and get ready to go.
The creek reached its banks, and now the maintenance yard became the main creekway. And so that was due to the high tides, the storm surge, and the water was not going anywhere.
And it was literally airplanes that were not tied down and should have been were just sort of sweeping their way down the runways or the taxiways.
That 24-hour period, we got 8 inches of water. There was nothing we could do. All we could do is go out into the field by foot or however we can get around and protect our tenants, our buildings, and do whatever we can from there and our infrastructure.
Had a controller who lived in Santa Maria, came all the way in, and his wife was 8 and a half, 9 months pregnant. Got to the facility, wasn't here 10 minutes, and the phone rang, and it was his wife. She was in labor. And we couldn't get out of the tower. There was just no way. The water was 7 or 8 feet deep behind the tower. So a petroleum helicopter offered to come over, and they came over, and they plucked him off the tower and flew him to Santa Maria so he could be home for his first child's birth. The reason I say that way is it's the uniqueness of the airport. It's everybody working together. The airport proprietor, the users, the air traffic control system, everybody comes to work with a stake in how successful we are. We built a state-of-the-art air traffic control facility, which was mimicked or redone several other places because of the uniqueness of it. And due to the size, we were able to be the test bed for many state-of-the-art enhancements to the air traffic system.
In the early 1970s, the airport briefly became a venue for something very different from air traffic or business. It involved one of the largest gatherings on airport property ever seen.
On May 8th of 1972, a friend of mine called and said that Nixon had mined the Haiphong Harbor, the port for Hanoi, which was kind of a dangerous, provocative act because the Russians were in and out of there providing humanitarian and military assistance. So there was going to be a big meeting on campus out behind the USN in order for people to understand what was going on and to see if there's some way we could demonstrate our displeasure with that. But then Jim Gregory, who was the editor and writer for the News and Review, the local weekly entertainment and political rag at the time, he suggested that Governor Reagan, a noted war hawk, was arriving that afternoon at the airport, that we should go down to the airport and shut it down and prevent him from coming, and that would be a statement. Well, everybody was kind of nudging each other, clapping, you know, and so about 2 o'clock, we started down Los Caneros. 2,000 or 3,000 people.
Oh, they came in on the west end of the airport and they marched across the runway and they thought, had hopes that they would see the airplanes come in and then all of a sudden have to divert, but they didn't realize the tower had diverted the airplanes long before they got here. They milled around out there for a while, and then they spray painted some words on the runway, and they weren't nice words, of course. It was peaceful. I mean, they just kind of dispersed and went away.
The sheriff came out and announced that we had to disperse. It was an unlawful crowd. And we looked down the runway, and way at the end, there were six across, two deep, black and whites, sitting there. They were kind of waving in the light of the heat of their engines. And he ordered them to start. And they start coming up the runway towards us, and about half the crowd splits. But we held our ground, I guess you could say. And about halfway towards us, the sheriff called them off, and they stopped. And everybody cheered, and somebody came out and announced that the rest of the flights for the day had been canceled. So we had won, and we stayed another half hour, 45 minutes, I guess.
Many times, the challenges of managing the Santa Barbara Airport came from even more unexpected sources.
It was a unique experience. My third or fourth day here, we were visited by the Secret Service, the FBI, the Air Force, many entities, and put together, even back then, a plan for arrivals and departures to the president by a helicopter to the ranch. We also had many contingency plans in place, which we used sometimes. But each visit to the president was unique. We would always know well in advance when the president was coming. There were additional security constraints intimated here at the airport, also at the ranch. We would always have pre-assembly meetings with the key parties to ensure that everybody understood when the president would arrive and how he would arrive. And there were several times where he was unable to land at the ranch because of fog, and he had to divert into Santa Barbara by a helicopter.
It was very exciting to have, regardless of what political party that you follow, to have a president actually, you know, come through your airport. Also, when Clinton was elected, when he was just president-elect, he also came in and, you know, I think it was pretty well known about him going to the Nugget in Summerlin, and so that was pretty exciting as well. We've had, over the years, the Dalai Lama come in. He was being hosted by UCSB. Of course, many actors and actresses, politicians, this seemed to be one of their whistle stops during election years. So for a small airport, it was, you know, it's a pretty exciting little place, I think, because Santa Barbara area is so progressive.
We've done a lot of presidential arrivals and vice presidential arrivals. We have a lot of experience working with the Secret Service. You know, not that they call the shots, but they have a lot of say, but they really depend on us to let them know what's going to work for us. And we do a good job of that. We're not shy about that. And we work well with both Secret Service, Capitol Police, and the Air Force advance teams that come out for Air Force One and Air Force Two. They're the folks that, you know, really are worried about where the plane is parking and who's servicing it, and they check out, you know, the airfield dimensions.
The effort between the Secret Service and all the government entities, including the city of Santa Barbara, the airport proprietor, did a first-class job of providing service to the president and his entourage.
It was a different essential service provided by the Santa Barbara Airport, however, that still fills the citizens of Santa Barbara with pride and a sense of life-saving accomplishment.
Every morning during the fire season, when we had an active blaze, we would meet, myself, my staff would meet with the chief pilots and the staff personnel at the tanker base and go over what the fire plan was, how we were going to provide services, the runways that we were going to utilize, the times to the fire burns, the weather.
It's been primarily used, even from its inception, as an initial attack, where you can get something to a fire, that either water, retardant, whatever product, to the fire, make some drops, keep it small, get the ground troops there, and put it out.
The visitor center was on the left-hand side, and that place used to get packed. What they would see is a parking tender coming out and marshaling the aircraft in, parking it, and then the retardant crew go in with the loading hose, hook up, took anywhere from about 6 minutes to 10 minutes, and then you'd see the crew shut the plane back up, and they'd start to, you know, the marshaller would get them the okay to start once everybody was clear from the plane, and then marshal them out.
20, 30 air tankers dispersed all over the airport, waiting to go in to be refueled and to be loaded on with retardant, and off they'd go. And several of the fires right around the foothills here, they would be gone for 4 minutes and come back and land and load up again.
The Forest Service had bleachers out there at the fueling point or the loading point, and you'd sit there and they'd have charts out where the fire was and what the activity, and you'd sit there and watch all day long if you wanted to. And that was one of my favorite activities, because I came over here, kids would come with me and we'd watch.
There were always some folks there who seemed to really know the operation, and so they could explain to some of the observers what was happening. I came and watched it a few times. They'd get, you know, 6-7 planes going. They'd line them up on hotel and leave Charlie clear. And then as one would fill up while the engines are hot, while they're running, they fill it with fuel, fill it with Fosgate, and roll it around and take it off as another one rolls in. It was an assembly line.
We had 13 air tankers there at any given time. They were all large air tankers. So it was pretty much nonstop all day from sun up to sundown.
When I was working at Santa Barbara Aviation, we'd work till 5 o'clock. And in the evening, when the Borate bombers finally shut down, when it got dark, Charlie Oliver and I would go down there and work on the airplanes till maybe till midnight, to get them, you know, if they had squawks and things that needed to be fixed so they could fly the next day.
In one day on the Romero fire, we did 159,000 gallons. And nothing ever stopped for 14 hours that day.
I think that fire went for almost 10 days, and I was beat, you know, working from about 5 o'clock to 11 o'clock in the morning to about 11 o'clock at night. And we lived probably about 40, 45 minutes away, so little sleep, long durations, and I think, what did he tell me? I look like I've been rode hard and put away wet. I'm all.
The one time when California was burning practically, and then there was a time the C-130 from Dover, Delaware had to bring us retardant all the way from there because factory couldn't keep up with it. It was, that was a bad year, really bad year.
Several times we had to suspend operations, other than the essential operations. Medevac flights were naturally were permitted and encouraged to go and so forth. But yeah, there were times when we would have to delay air carriers coming into the airport. There were times that military would have to divert that someplace else. And the primary thrust was that the air tankers had priority other than an actual emergency, and we were going to do everything possible for that particular effort.
We did our very best to issue the notices to airmen necessary to make sure that we had particular taxiways closed to other people so they could stage on those taxiways. We made sure their ramp area was clear, worked with the tower, you know, no one taxis over there. So they had really all the room they needed to do the operation they needed to do. And then of course, they worked well with the tower to get our scheduled flights off in between the firefighting flights so that we could maintain schedules without delay concurrently with the firefighting service.
The pilots were pretty good, you know, when they go turn around, because they used to come in straight to the airbase, and then as they did a tight turn out, you know, the captain would actually be looking towards the visitor center, and most of the pilots, you know, would wave, you know, and especially if the kids were out there.
They don't necessarily do it for the money. They're paid well, but you're not going to get rich by it. You're not going to, you know, and they love the flying. I don't know any of them that don't love the flying.
I got to know a lot of the pilots. Highly educated, highly motivated, really committed individuals to their profession. And it is a profession. It used to be years ago like they were cowboys and cowgirls. No way. These people are the epitome of professionalism.
And there's not a pilot that didn't love what they do, you know. That's why they do it. Once we had one of the OPB4Ys come in, and one of their front tires had blown out, went flat, so it was kind of stuck out there on the runway, you know, and as I said, we had good working relationships then, and I think it was Signature, it might have been Signature, it was still there, but boy, they came with their pulley for the aircraft, tugged it on, we got it pulled off, and I think we did that like within a half hour, just kept things still going. The Santa Barbara foothills, obviously, they're known for their sundowner winds, and you get those east winds. When you get those gusts, it can also, you know, cause sometimes some downdrafts. Some of the pilots would complain, man, you know, they hit some downdrafts and it shook the plane, you know, or them, you know, pretty hard. And so, obviously, when they're hitting those kind of conditions or multiple conditions, sometimes, you know, they would be flying and there's thunderstorms, or, you know, it's there was lightning around. Well, obviously it's not that safe of a condition, so we bring them in. I mean, obviously everybody wants to come home, you know. You never left until you knew the aircraft were all safe down on the ground, or they weren't coming home. And so, you know, it'd be, you know, 7 o'clock, you'd call up to the tanker base where they're working, if they were working in the area where they could fly back home, and they'd either say, yeah, they're coming back home. So you'd have to wait until they got back home, which would be dusk.
Sometimes they don't come back. There have been, I would have to look it up. I have the stats, but I don't remember them. I try not to. There have been a lot of losses and a lot of good friends of mine, pilots and co-pilots, that don't come back. several of them out of Santa Barbara.
I don't think any pilot is ever going to think that it's going to happen to them, one of those accidents. And, you know, for the most part, they have like a checklist that they go through. And sometimes, you know, accidents happen. It's obviously, it is, I think, considered, you know, a high risk job. I mean, now you look at it, for a while there, we were losing a tanker every year.
Most cases when an accident or an incident occurs where there's a fatality, the agencies take it on themselves to do a stand down. So that means, and that's nationwide stand down, all aircraft are stood down at least for that afternoon and maybe into the next day. And so in some ways that helps. When they happened here, we would do within a couple of weeks there would be a memorial service at the base out here in Santa Barbara, and I don't know if they're still there, because I haven't been out to that location where we used to be. But we had a lawn in back of the building, and we actually had four trees planted there, named for each one of the pilots.
In 2007, the air tanker base, which had provided strategic firefighting capabilities for 44 years, moved to Santa Maria.
When I first came to the airport in the mid-1980s, the previous director had been trying for some years to get approved safety areas at each end of our main runway. And there were many environmental issues, as you can imagine, because the airport is co-located with the Goleta Slough.
And with the Coastal Commission, you couldn't build anything in an endangered area like the slough unless it was for safety.
And the FAA requires safety areas at each end of the runway. During our master plan in the late 1990s, we worked with the environmental community and were successful getting support not only for the runway safety area project, but mitigation in the slough to restore wetlands. So it was a win-win for both, safety, passenger safety, as well as the environment. So we constructed the project. We moved Tecolotito Creek and re-vegetated it with wetland plants, as well as created many acres of wetlands and restored it in the Goleta Slough.
Both wetland and upland plants were replanted on site. We did approximately four times the amount we displaced.
So we've, restored through various projects, but the bulk of it through the runway safety area project, acres and acres of the slough that otherwise would not have been restored.
September 11th, 2001, changed the way Americans would travel by air forever.
The TSA was created shortly after 9/11. I believe most people know that the Federal Aviation Administration, the FAA, airport security was one of their many duties. Once September 11 happened, the federal government created the Transportation Security Administration, and they took over security duties from the FAA.
The Transportation Security Administration introduced better screening equipment and new luggage screening that positively matched people and their bags.
The federal government had done many surveys of the public, and I know there were professional surveys done, and the surveys showed that in general, the American public wanted to see security taken on by the federal government. They wanted to see better paid, highly professional, dedicated people doing security so that they would have more faith in it.
Even though the new security measures improved passenger safety, many pilots still remember the airport's easy access that they used to enjoy, and sometimes reflect with nostalgia for the older, simpler times flying at the Santa Barbara Airport.
It's the old barnstorming kind of pilots, the older ones who remember flying in, no fences, no barbed wire, and they were able to go on and have their own little groups and meet around tea hangers and have a barbecue and not worry about regulations or restrictions. And today, they can't even access their airplane without a badge and without a secret code to get into the airfield, and it is restrictive.
With the runway safety up to FAA standards, the refurbishing of the valuable wetland habitat, and the implementation of the new security standards by the TSA, airport staff turned their attention back toward the long-standing need to upgrade and modernize the air terminal. For many years, the Santa Barbara Airport Terminal, built by United Airlines in the 1940s, was a refreshing surprise for travelers coming to Santa Barbara for the first time.
I used to get a kick when I was flying in myself at the old terminal. It was fun to watch people get off an airplane and they'd be telling their seatmate, you know, have you ever been to Santa Barbara? No. Oh, you're going to love this terminal. Well, there wasn't much to love functionally, but it was such a beautiful thing.
The old terminal was just wonderful. And it was, you know, it was so different from just about anything you would see, even, you know, with other medium-sized cities like Santa Barbara. Not only, you know, beautiful architecture, but also just, you know, very homey and laid back. And I remember it as being, you know, always a fun place to go, whether I was flying or whether, you know, people were coming in.
In 1951, or close to the time that picture of me was taken, we had 13,000 passengers in a year go through that terminal. And with minor modifications that happened in 1976, I think, they did 225,000 people in a year. And in 1997, without modifying it again, we had 845,000 people go through the terminal. So you can see there was a need.
A new 72,000 square foot two-story Spanish Colonial Revival air terminal was opened August 18th, 2011. This terminal goes a long way towards Santa Barbara's dedication to perfecting the art of travel.
When we started thinking about a new terminal, one of the things that we wanted to prevent was what had happened in the past is that there was not a lot of support or public sentiment that we needed a new terminal. So we really wanted to start off on the right foot. We got our stakeholders together. We did a Airline Terminal 101 for council and all the design review body members, as well as Airport Commission, to really educate them on, you know, the needs of a terminal, how they're designed and to be functional, as well as beautiful. We knew it would be beautiful because that's Santa Barbara style, but it also needed to function as an airline terminal.
Goal was to really try to come up with a design that reflected what the community was telling us they wanted to see out of a new airport. And, you know, one of the challenges was to take this little airport that was kind of this wonderful icon that everybody loves, and I've heard over the years how cool it is to fly in the evening when the sun is setting and the breeze is blowing and get off the airplane and it's like being in a movie and touching the ground. And yet we were going to try to move all of that idea into a new state-of-the-art, high-technology air terminal.
We wanted that Santa Barbara experience. So when somebody flew in here, who have been flying in here for 30 years, when they came to the new terminal, to have the same experience, even though it's going to be larger, but that same feeling, that same quaintness.
The new airline terminal is registered with the United States Green Building Council Leadership in Energy and Environmental Design, or LEED, the nationally recognized benchmark for design, construction, and operation of high-performance green buildings.
Early on, the City Council said, look, Santa Barbara leads the way in sustainability. And so an early effort was made to do this as a LEED project. We have active systems, we've got solar panels, we had passive activities, the kind of paint we used, the kind of materials we used, where the materials came from. We were very careful because there's embodied energy in getting materials here. So selecting something instead of coming from Europe, come from Washington or within 500 mile radius of Santa Barbara.
As the largest construction project ever undertaken by the city, staying within the budget was critical. Even with a $63 million budget, no local tax dollars were used. The project was funded through a combination of debt financing, passenger facility charge, FAA grants, and 2% from the airport. One of the most important elements at the new airline terminal is the inclusion of public art.
The arts program is probably the most significant thing outside my job that I was involved in this project, and not being an artist or knowing really very much about art at all, it was very exciting to work with Jenny Brush and Rita Ferry from the County Arts Commission, with the Visual Arts and Public Places Committee and the City Arts Advisory Committee, and you know, selecting artists for our commissioned work and the loaned work that we got. It was very exciting to me and gratifying to see how beautiful it all brought the terminal together.
The public art program is comprised of three elements: commissioned art, long-term loan of existing art, and rotating exhibits of regional art.
I think the artistic elements that were added to this terminal building are magnificent, and I think people from around the world have commented on and will comment on the detailed work in the ceilings, the paintings, the mosaic that represents all of Santa Barbara, and how that came about was so amazingly wonderful.
Three local artists were commissioned to design and install artworks inside the new terminal.
We wanted to do something that was to us as artists, what inspired us emotionally about Santa Barbara. And we settled on its beauty. And its beauty meaning its natural flora, its natural landscape, and its architecture.
One of the things that we wanted to have translated into the new building was the Santa Barbara Airport experience. And part of that is the landscaping. You could sit outside, the human scale of the building, but also to share the culture of our region. And I can't think of a better way to do that than through art.
Taking a look back at the project from when it first began, one could see that the arduous journey was complex. But with detailed planning and determination, most anyone will agree that in the end, the new Santa Barbara Airport Terminal and the renovation of the old terminal creates a welcoming gateway that truly reflects Santa Barbara's unique character.
Airline industry, the aviation industry as we know it, it will change, it will move on, it will add, it will increase, it will do lots of things. The hope is that this core building will allow for that flexibility. The building was designed in a way that both the north end of the building and the south end of the building can be added to relatively easy.
I think the finished airport is very beautiful. It's an example of a community coming together and designing something for the future.
But I also feel really proud that we're able to construct a new terminal that meets modern passenger needs and also is beautiful.
Just as the new terminal has incorporated much of Santa Barbara's aviation history, it also provides a chance, through its design and character, to capture and reconnect passengers to the things that make the experience of flying unique and special, and also a chance to pay homage to the pioneers whose bravery, foolhardiness, intelligence, and creativity helped shape our world of flight.
I think my favorite days would be when someone soloed the first time, because you kind of relive your own first solo. And then to be able to cut the tradition is after they've soloed safely and they come back in, they're all excited because it's a big day. They say you remember your first solo as well as you remember the day you got married. I remember my solo, but I don't remember when I got married.
I think aviation is unique in a way that it's a family endeavor. People work together, they joke, They have disagreements, but there is always the purpose of safety comes first. And I think when there is an accident, there is a sense of loss of a family member. And you can sense it in the tower. You can sense it from other air traffic controllers. And that sort of circle the wagons and are there to provide support and strength to get through whatever the incident is.
We were starting to move fast. We went well over flap speed. And it got up to a certain speed, and the flaps caused a turbulence over the tail so that we could no longer control the airplane. The nose simply dropped. And we were looking straight down at these birds that were starting to scatter because they could see us coming. They were smart, we weren't. Yeah, Conroy put the thing into what they call beta, which flattened the propeller out, and the airplane just came to a stop in the air. And then as soon as it got the speed drop, we were able to pull out of the thing. And he was shaking. He didn't say a word, and I didn't say a word. Then he turned to me and he says, "Something like that'll start your heart."
Dreamers, I wish I could have, or I wish I could. I think everyone would probably like to learn to fly, but to the average person, they think, oh, it's too hard. It's too expensive, that's for sure. Very expensive. But I always say that if it's something you really, really want, you'll find a way. I don't know. There's something about flying by yourself that, I don't know, it's a freedom that you don't have any other time. I loved looking at clouds and being close to them and looking down at things and seeing all the beautiful things that are there. It gives you a totally different perspective of the world.